Today I am here with a rather interesting instrument. Now, if you're familiar with harpsichords, you might be looking at this and getting all excited. You're like, yay, you found another harpsichord. But I'm sorry, don't get too excited because it's actually a piano. But what's interesting is it has a harpsichord style case. And in fact, even the shape of the case as well as the way it opens up is basically just like a harpsichord. Now, normally a piano, just like this one, it has a fallboard. And so you take the fallboard and you close it down, and that is how you cover the keys. It's a very simple, in this piano, it's a one piece mechanism that simply lowers down and covers the keys. But on this piano, because it's styled like a harpsichord, it's a much fancier mechanism. We have this huge lid that lifts up, then this that comes up. Then it folds back like this, just like a harpsichord, to reveal the piano. Now, you might still have doubts that this is a piano because it still could be a harpsichord, but as you can see, it has a Steinway and Sons name down there, which of course Steinway made pianos, and as you can see, if I play a chord here, it is indeed a piano. So it's a very, very special and very, very unusual piano. Now, I've been told that this is one of three pianos like this in the world that have ever been made, and that's incredible. This is one of three pianos. We have a serial number over here, and this is a Steinway L. So this is the serial number 271148. Now, I believe that this was made in maybe 1929 or 1931, somewhere right in that time period. And so if you want to do a little bit of research, you can look up that serial number and tell me when this piano was made. And it's really, really cool. So as you can see here, it has, I believe this is a walnut finish, and we have lots of cool little inlays. They're very subtle, but they're very cool. If you notice them, even here on the music desk, we have a little extra strips of wood that have been laid in to the piano and making designs, and there's actually this whole section here is also a different section because the grain doesn't line up there, and you can see the lines where they've been joined together. We have more of these inlays here as well on the piano. That's a funny little triangle right down there. I guess the way they joined that is kind of unusual, and it made that little triangle shaped piece. That's kind of funny. We have more inlays here. They're very subtle, but they're really cool, and I really like them. And we also have the very simple little spiral, kind of like a snail shell shape, or there's just a spiral kind of scroll shape there at the side, which is a nice little touch. Now, I believe that this piano, I think it has been rebuilt, but I think it was rebuilt quite some time ago. And because you can see that the tuning pins, they're not the original ones, but they are a little bit old, maybe 10, 15 years old. So this piano was rebuilt, but I believe it was rebuilt maybe 10 to 15 years ago. And so it's very, very interesting. Now, I mentioned that this piano has a harpsichord style case, and of course the lid was shaped much differently than on a standard piano. You know, the fallboard is what I mean. And then if you come here and look at this, this is also a harpsichord feature where the side of the instrument sticks out and kind of like, you know, it comes out along the instrument, and then on a piano, like here, it curves down, and there's not this giant wall of wood here, but on a harpsichord, there's like a giant wall of wood that comes out, and this piano retains that shape, which I find is kind of interesting. So I'm back here at the back of this piano because, like I said, the front of the piano is styled like a harpsichord, and so is the back of the piano. Now, if we take a look at this more modern baby grand over here, we can see that the shape of the piano is very round and very curved at the back, and that is the shape of a piano that we all know and love. Now, if we come back here, you might have noticed the shape of this piano is different. It's pointed. It comes back here, it makes a point, and then it kind of curves very gently, and then makes another point back here, and then heads back up towards the front of the piano. And in fact, that's not just the lid, the actual rim of the piano has a big corner right down here, and it also has another corner right over here. And that is actually a feature of harpsichords. When harpsichords were being made, instead of taking the rim of the instrument and bending it around, they simply took pieces of wood and joined them together at the corners. And that is how this piano was made, to kind of harken back to the days of a harpsichord, to make it look like a harpsichord. And so that's kind of interesting. Bösendorfer actually does that today with their newer pianos, like the 290 and I think maybe the 225. One of those pianos, a couple of them, actually have the same kind of a shape. The rest of the piano looks like a piano, but they have those little creases to, again, harken back to the days of early pianos and harpsichords that have a corner at the back instead of a nice curve. So, but now you're probably curious, what does this piano sound like? So I'm going to go back up to the front of the piano, play a couple songs on it, and let you know what it sounds like. So now we've got the lid of the piano open, and we've got the fallboard open once again, and I will play, first I'll play my original piece that I wrote to test out pianos, and then after that I'll play some Bach on this piano, which I think will be very fitting, so hopefully you enjoy it. Thank you. piano has a very nice sound for such an old piano. It has the original soundboard, which is kind of interesting, and we'll take a look at that. And it has the kind of like an older, warm kind of sound, and it's very nice. So now let's have a listen to what Bach sounds like on this piano as well. So that kind of gave you an idea of what the mid-range and kind of the bass end of the piano sounds like. It has a very nice sounding bass for such a small piano. Again, it's the original soundboard as well, which I kind of find is neat, that they left that in because the soundboard was perfectly fine and it helps retain some of the character of this original piano from 1929, 1931, somewhere around that time. So of course you can tell by looking at the outside of this piano that it's pretty old, but you can also look at the inside and get some visual cues as to why it's old. First of all, if we take a look at the portholes, the nubs are gone around the portholes. Now if you don't know what I mean by the nubs are gone, before the 1920s, Steinway had these little round, I mean they're nubs, they were like little kind of domes around the portholes, and they had them around all the portholes, but Steinway discontinued that before 1920. So if you look at the inside of a Steinway piano and it has those nubs around the portholes, you'll know that it was from before 1920. But since this is after 1920, it's around the 1930s, those nubs are gone, but you can still tell that the harp is old because of a couple of reasons. First of all, the harp has some kind of minor imperfections. There's some little bumps and little, imperfections when the harp was made, and it's totally normal and it's only aesthetic. What I find funny is when they stamped in the patent grand construction font, part of the C is actually missing. It's just kind of like two little semicircles, and it's actually kind of funny that part of the C is missing. I've never seen that before. It's like a little accidental typo on the inside of the piano, as you can see right there. Part of the C is actually missing right there. So that's kind of funny. But as you can tell by all this font down here that says Steinway Foundry Cast String, Tubular Metallic Action Frame Patents, and also this big Steinway badge here, this is an older style harp, and Steinway does not use this style of harp anymore. They have a much more modern, very smooth, it would not have any of these imperfections because of the way we cast them today, and it's just very interesting. Also, it's kind of funny, the harp has a strange, it kind of reminds me of like some kind of a geometric shape down here because of the shape of the rim. And the harpsichord style, it has a different style harp that I've never noticed before. So I think that is special to this piano, but it might not be. The bridge down here, I'm noticing, you probably can't see on camera, but it's actually made of not quite bird's eye maple, but it's made of some kind of a special wood like that has a very nice grain to it. And I'm surprised that they use such a nice grain on a part of the piano that nobody would ever see. And also, if you take a look at the soundboard is what I find interesting in this piano. You can really see it down here. See all those lines that run diagonally against the strings on the soundboard? That is literally the soundboard. Those aren't repairs or shims. That's actually the grain of the wood on the soundboard, and I've never ever seen that before on a piano. Usually on a soundboard, the wood is a very pale color. If it's aged, it'll have a darker color, but usually it's a very consistent wood color. But here we have all of these crazy wood grains that run all the way down into the back of the piano, and there's even like a little knot down here. You won't be able to see it, but there's actually like a little dark knot, and there's even like a little indentation where the knot is on the soundboard. So that's really interesting. I wonder why they chose to do that. It's very interesting. I've never seen that before. One other thing that's really interesting about this piano is I mentioned earlier that the rim and the shape of the piano is different from a normal piano because instead of curving, it has these corners, and you can see the corners, but you can also see a traditional piano shape. Again, you look at the shape of this piano and the rim of it curves around as usual, and you look at the inside of the rim of this piano, And it also curves around as usual, and the inside of the rim is shaped like a normal piano, but yet somehow it has these corners as well. And normally the rim of a piano is bent, and I don't know how they would have made this because it looks like it's all one piece. It could be that this is a veneer that runs along the top, and then they bent the rim in place as usual, and then glued on like a kind of a curved triangle piece, and then put veneer over it. I think that's how they would have made this. So they would have made a normal piano room, and then attached extra pieces, and then put veneer over those extra pieces to make it look like it was all one piece. I think that's how they would have made this. But it's very interesting. I didn't really expect to see that. I actually thought they would have constructed the rim in a different manner. As you can see there, the lid prop has some nice little carvings on it too to match the legs, which we will take a look at in a minute. We have that little ring up there at the top, and then as well as it's all natural wood color, and then down here we have some other decorative carvings as well. This little twist tie actually holds the key in place. So this is the original Steinway key. As you can see, it's a triangle shape, which is used on older pianos. And what's funny is if you have one of these triangle keys, they work on any old piano with that triangle size key. I don't think they had different sizes and diameters of triangle key. It was just a simple shape that works easily. But if you have one triangle key like this, you can open any old triangle key style piano, which they used in the early 1900s, I guess as late as the 1930s, and probably even later. But as you can see, it has the Steinway style logo there. So this is a Steinway key. It even has like a little and symbol in the middle. The technical name for that is an ampersand. And I assume that refers to the Steinway and Sons. So I thought that was kind of interesting that it comes with the original key. So now let's take a look at the legs of the lyre and also an interesting feature that's at the bottom of this piano. So here I am underneath of the other piano that I was using to compare this piano to. This what we're looking at here is the harpsichord piano. And as you can see, there's an interesting feature along the underside of the piano. It has this crazy diagonal brace that goes from the back legs all the way up to the front legs, and then it has more braces that go out from the lyre to the main legs here. And as you can see, these legs have a interesting design to them. They're kind of like two legs in one that are connected at the bottom and then also connected in the middle with that mini brace. And then, as I said, there's a brace that goes to the lyre, which also has a very similar aesthetic. And then, as you can see, there is that wild brace that goes all the way back to the back legs of the piano. Now, I assume for moving this piano, it comes apart, because typically when people move pianos, the legs pop off, they tilt them up on the side, and then they're able to fit them through doors and stuff. I don't know how that would work with this. You might have to move it all in one piece, but I imagine it comes apart somehow. There's also some interesting bracing underneath the piano as well. Look at those little carved pieces of wood that go all the way up to the front of the piano and then go all the way to the back as well. I've never seen that before either, and I think that is kind of interesting too. So there you go, that's the underside of the harpsichord piano, the one of three supposedly pianos that are in existence. They're certainly rare. I have never seen one. The shop owner has never seen one aside from this one. So they are certainly rare, and they're very interesting. So hopefully you guys have enjoyed this very interesting video on this very interesting piano. Now again, I'm sorry it's not a harpsichord. I know a lot of my fans really love harpsichords, but this is kind of the best of both worlds, and on top of that, it's an incredibly rare piano. It's a piano, but it looks like a harpsichord, and also apparently it's one of only three pianos like this that are ever made. Again, I was told that it might be maybe only one of two, or it might be maybe one of five, but whatever the number of pianos that like this were ever made, they're very, very rare, and I've never seen anything quite like this before, and probably you haven't ever seen anything quite like this either. Now, if you're curious as to where I found this, you want to come see it for yourself, or you just want to come visit the store, I'll put their information in the description of this video because they have lots of really cool stuff, and they're an awesome store, and you know, this alone is a really good reason to come visit. It's a one of three piano, it's awesome. So anyway, hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to go check out my channel, I've got lots of videos on new Steinways, old Steinways. I've got a video on a harpsichord and a clavichord, and hopefully more to come if I manage to come across actual harpsichords. But in the meantime, we have a harpsichord piano, so hopefully you enjoyed it. If you want to subscribe, you can do that. And if you do subscribe, thank you very much, and I'll see you in the next video. Goodbye.